everyone. My name is Amanda Mecker. I'm a BCBA and the Director of Clinical Services Northeast at Brett DiNovi Associates. In this video today, we're going to talk about stimulus equivalence.
The BACB task list references stimulus equivalence under section E06, Use Stimulus Equivalence Procedures, and FK12, Define and Provide Examples of Stimulus Equivalence. Stimulus equivalence is defined as classes of stimuli categorized by reflexivity, symmetry, and transitivity among members.
When developing programming for teaching learners to develop language and discrimination skills, it can be helpful to consider stimulus equivalence. Sometimes referred to as equivalence relations or derived equivalence relations, and it can help to develop comprehensive programming for discriminations and for language development. In 1986, Stephen Hayes described the phenomenon of stimulus equivalence to say that when humans are taught a series of related conditional discriminations, the component stimuli of the discriminations often become related to each other in new ways that have not been explicitly taught in training. This is the crux of the phenomenon of stimulus equivalence. The explicit training of related stimuli leads to behavior that indicates untrained stimuli have become related as a functional stimulus class, even though it was never explicitly taught. So you taught some student that these two things are related, and even though you didn't teach that third and fourth thing are related, those become related. With consideration of the symbolic nature of language, it becomes evident why derived relations can be key to rapid language development and acquisition. A word can be considered an arbitrary stimulus that, in a Skinnerian view of language, comes to occasion a set of behaviors through contingencies of reinforcement. For example, the word cookie symbolizes a small, sweet, delicious, usually, food. The symbol of the word cookie can be used to tact, command, or otherwise refer to the object of a cookie. The word, an auditory stimulus, cookie, has no formal similarity to the object that you would eat. There is a symbolic relationship between the word cookie and the small sweet food, the delicious thing that is called a cookie. Ruth Ann Ray Feltz, stating that Sidman in 1971 initially demonstrated that individuals with severe intellectual disabilities read printed words and matched printed words to pictures and pictures to printed words, a skill purportedly indicative of reading comprehension. After being instructed to match dictated names to pictures and printed words. So to break that down, after having been explicitly taught that printed words match the auditory stimulus of a word and the auditory stimulus of a word matched a picture, those students in the study were able to match the self-generated auditory stimulus of the word that matched the printed word, again with no formal similarity, and match printed words to pictures without having ever been taught. There are three stimulus equivalencies to really get down in order to understand how to apply stimulus equivalence or derive stimulus equivalence in a clinical setting.
There is reflexivity,
which means A equals A is explicitly taught. So your student can derive independently of any teaching that A equals A. That sounds a little bit obvious. But when you think about it in a clinical context, when you have a student that is learning to match identical pictures or identical objects, it's not necessarily a given that other identical pictures or other identical objects outside of this training stimuli will necessarily be matched. The second stimulus equivalency
is symmetry.
A equals B. And so without any teaching at all, the student should be able to derive that B equals A. If you have a picture of a car and a toy car, and you teach your student to match the picture to the object without any teaching at all per stimulus equivalency, that student should be able to match the object of the car to the picture. A equals B, therefore B equals A.
The third and final stimulus equivalence is transitivity. Transitivity states that when taught A equals B and that B equals C, it can be derived that A equals C.
So that one's a little bit more complex to spot in the natural environment, but when you know what to look for, it can become very straightforward. If you teach a student that the word car is equivalent to a picture of a car, teach that same student that that picture of a car is the same as the toy car, it can be derived that the auditory word car is the same as the toy car. And that's true across all different examples. Those are very simple examples of an audio stimulus, a written stimulus, and an object stimulus. The same holds with picture stimuli across the environment, things that are just written or things that are purely spoken. Thanks so much. My name is Amanda Mecker, BCBA and Director of Clinical Services of Brett DiNovi and Associates. Please tune in to see more videos.